The Legion of Merit.
The Legion of Merit, okay.
And that has something to do with the Nuremberg trials.
Oh, okay.
Matter of fact, this is the highest award that was given to anyone in service, for service at Nuremberg. I was the only one, in other words, to get the Legion of Merit.
Congratulations.
Yes.
After serving the Navy on active duty for 3.5 years, the Navy transferred me to OSS. Mm-hmm. And I went through all the training and everything, and then they sent me to Europe in charge of the investigation of war crimes for the European, in the European theater for OSS. So I set up my office down on St. James, close by British intelligence, because I could get more stuff from British intelligence than I could get running around by myself. And then Jackson came over to negotiate the agreement for the trial of the German war criminals with the British, French, and Russian representatives, and he set up his offices on Mount Street. And at that time, of course, I got acquainted with him. And at that time, they didn't have any evidence to speak of. But I was picking up evidence, mm-hmm. you know, and documents from time. So whenever I got a good one, I'd take it up to Mount Street and give it to him. I don't remember who it was that I talked with up there at this time. But anyway, that way I became acquainted with the staff, and so somebody suggested that I come down to Nuremberg in August, and so I, as far as OSS is concerned, I could do my work down there just as well as in London, so I said, oh sure, I'll go down to Nuremberg, and of course I pretty much dropped OSS then. Jackson took the representatives of the other countries down to Nuremberg and looked it over, the Palace of Justice. The
right.
main thing, the two reasons that we selected Nuremberg for the trial, of course the headquarters for the proceeding was Berlin
right.
at all times. That was the legal headquarters. But for the actual trial, Nuremberg was selected because there was a very fine Palace of Justice there. Mm-hmm. Which, however, had been severely damaged in the war. And but it was a big, big prison, and had as well as a courthouse mm-hmm. joined together, which is perfect.
Right.
And the other thing was, it was in the American zone. And whoever's going to conduct this trial is going to have to feed everybody and maintain order and so forth, and that logically would fall to America, so Jackson was recommended that we go with Nuremberg, though Nuremberg was terribly smashed. It was destroyed. The town was a mess, and it wasn't a very happy environment. They housed us outside of Nuremberg in a little town called Dahlem, which had not been damaged, and we took over houses, and we were stationed in various houses. We were in I think Jackson's house was close by our house.
Mm-hmm.
I think Bernie was in my, Bernie Meltzer was also in my house. I'm pretty sure Bernie was, yeah. Bob Story was Jackson's executive trial counsel, and he was really in charge of the allocation of the work that the various lawyers did.
Okay. So when you sort of drift from the OSS to Nuremberg, you're basically under Story's
direction. Well, yes, you see,
it
was perfectly logical what I would do at Nuremberg, because since I had been at OSS, and I hadn't been at OSS that long, really, because
right.
I'd been in the Navy, in active duty in the Navy, but the months that I had spent in London with OSS, as far as Bob Story was concerned, well, here's somebody that can take over the handle of the Gestapo and the SD, because these are repressive agencies were joined with the German intelligence under the RSHA, that's the Reich Sicherheitshauptamt, the Reich Main Security Office. So he said, you take care of that case, that's your business, and take care of Kaltenbrunner, who was the head of the RSHA. So that's why I was given that best part of the whole lawsuit, really, if you want to call it best, you know, the most terrible in some sense. So the story gave me a little office in the Palace of Justice and a German secretary and a second hand typewriter and said, go to work and prove the lawsuit against Ernst Kaltenbrunner and the Gestapo and the SD. And I did it all by myself. I had nobody else to help me. It was a one-man job.
Did you have any part in the drafting of the charges?
No.
Or the indictment already existed and you just had to put together a case?
Yeah. The alderman, Sidney Alderman, did most of that. I had nothing to do with that.
Okay.
I think that was very good.
Okay.
I think the concept was excellent. Jackson realized that the scope of this trial could not extend very far to cover very many people, by naming these organizations as criminal organizations and proving that they did engage in criminal conduct, then those individuals who joined, knowing that that was the type of agency that they were becoming part of, had to have some criminal responsibility. I think that was all right. The tribunal was quite concerned about the scope of punishment which might be visited upon members of these so-called criminal organizations, and that this might lead to massive reprisals by the Germans against Germans. And they made it very clear that you couldn't charge anyone with criminality because of membership in a criminal organization,
right,
unless you could establish that he joined voluntarily, was not conscripted, joined voluntarily, and that he had knowledge of the evil purposes of the organization. Well, within those limitations, I think that the charge was correct and that the convictions were right.
Mm-hmm. Why did the tribunal have such difficulty with that concept?
Well, the tribunal didn't have difficulty with it.
Well, they acquitted some organizations.
Oh, well, because it couldn't prove the criminality. We couldn't prove the criminality of the high command.
Okay.
You couldn't prove it.
Okay.
I mean, the evidence wasn't there.
Okay.
But for my organization, I didn't have any trouble. It could stop on the SD and, of course, the SS. That was
right.
That was another easy one.
Right.
And the leadership core of the Nazi Party was another one, Dinamonte.
The SA, too, didn't they?
Huh?
They convicted the SA, too, didn't they?
The SA was...
No,
it was not convicted. It's a criminal organization. There were four of us. There was the leadership core of the party, the Gestapo and the SD, those are my organizations, and the... and the SS. How the work was divided, we had organized that. That was part of our responsibility, the criminal organizations. That was an American matter to prove. So, of course, we did have some, contact back and forth, of course, particularly with the British. Russia had to be given the opportunity to participate in this trial.
Sure.
And the only problem was a problem for Justice Jackson, in that the Russian viewpoint was, at the outset, a little bit different from ours. For example, General Nikolchenko, who was the Russian representative at the negotiations in London, indicated that from a Russian viewpoint, that the matter of criminality had already been decided by heads of state, that there wasn't any issue as to whether any crimes had been committed. It was only the question of who committed the crime and the amount of punishment, that's all. So, you know, this is completely, Justice Ashton couldn't accept any viewpoint like sure. this, and he expressed himself very vociferously to that effect and indicated that, you know, if that's they're going to be their position, then they'd drop out of the trial. There wouldn't be any trial. There's no sense in having a trial like that. So the other point that was very difficult with the Russians at London was that they... what was it? That I'm trying to think.
The limiting it to Nazi to Axis aggression in Europe, was that the?
No. That they were all right on aggression. Oh no, the trial should only the definition of crime should be restricted to crimes committed by the European Axis. Mm-hmm. It's not that the European Axis was on trial, but that the crimes could only be charged as crimes committed by the European Axis. Well, of course, this is completely a nonsense, unacceptable. So these two points caused Jackson considerable trouble in the negotiations in London. And I don't know whether the Russians ever really gave way on them, but they accepted in the end, the definition of crimes that, in effect, that Justice Jackson proposed and the concept of the trial, which he insisted upon, so that part came out all right. Mm-hmm. And they, you know, they we had some trouble with them. For example, they wanted one of the really the seriously contested charges was the murder of the 10,000 Polish officers in the Katyn Forest. And right at the outset, the Russians wanted to charge that crime as a crime against the Germans. And Jackson was informed that by the State Department or somebody, War Department, that there's a big question about this. And maybe shouldn't do that. And he recommended that they not pursue that issue, but they insisted that they go forward with that charge. And of course, the Germans put on a terrific defense, and it was all a matter of timing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Were these Polish officers killed while the Russians were in occupation of the Katyn Forest, or when the while the Germans were in occupation?
Right.
The Russians said, "Well, the Germans were there, therefore they killed them." But they were able to find
stuff in the pockets.
Yeah, stuff in the pockets and stuff.
Russians, yeah.
Right.
And so the tribunal made no finding on that issue.
Right.
Now, of course, everybody knows that it was a Russian crime. The Russians have admitted it.
You sort of rose up from the ranks to become one of his favorites, if I may
well,
say so.
I really don't know. I suppose I'm just guessing that I don't know that I was a favorite. I think everybody. We were invited over to his house for dinner on occasion, and I really don't know. It's possible that stories may have said that Harris is doing a good job. I don't know. How do I know? I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But then we did work on his speeches and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Did you work on the opening speech with him at all?
Yes.
At the time that was delivered, did you appreciate it as just the masterpiece that it's appreciated now?
No, I don't think so. But now I do.
Yeah.
But believe me, my role in that was minuscule.
Yeah.
And we also contributed to his concluding speech too, mm-hmm. but he did the writing. It's don't think that anybody else had that much to do with it. Minor suggestion. His defense was really terribly weak. You know, he said his defense was, you see. Within the RSHA, he was appointed the head when Heydrich died. There was German intelligence and the repressive agencies. That's why I got the job, because of the intelligence part of it. And Kalbrenner said, well, when Himmler named me head of the RSHA, he told me to restrict myself to matters of intelligence and leave the Gestapo work to Mueller. And so he said, I didn't know anything about all these bad things happening in this concentration camp. He said, in fact, I never was in a concentration camp. That's a pretty good point there. I never was in the camp. He's the head of the RSHA, the head of the whole thing. I never was in the concentration camp. So, but I was able to disprove that because I found a photograph of himself at Zierreich down at Mauthausen, you see.
Oh, we don't.
And so that he was in the camp. But the big thing was he had never been in Auschwitz concentration camp. That was true. And that was a major point. So you'll really appreciate this as a lawyer. So I'd been searching for Rudolf Hess, who was a combat. H-O-E-S-S is his name, who was a commandant of Auschwitz concentration camp, because we knew that that was, of course, the worst of all the camps. And he'd hidden out, nobody knew where he was. And finally, after we rested our case, the British found him at near Flensburg. He'd been hiding out as a farmer. Now, this is the greatest killer of all mankind, is Rudolf Hess. So I had Rudolf first brought to Nuremberg, and I spent 3 days with him, interrogating him. And I got the complete story of Auschwitz, the most dramatic thing. I mean, no question about the complete truth of the terrible conditions of Auschwitz. Number one star witness for our side would be Rudolf Hess. But we had rested our case. So how are we going to get the evidence into the record? You know, this is, in America, this is a real problem.
It's a problem, sir.
So what happened? I turned him over to Kaufman, who is Kaltenbrunner's attorney, and Kaufman finds out that Rudolf Hess, had Kaltenbrunner ever been to Auschwitz? No, he'd never been to Auschwitz.
Uh-huh.
So Kaufman calls Hess as a witness for Kaltenbrunner for the defense. And we get my affidavit in the record and the whole thing. The luckiest break we ever had in the whole trial.
Oh, that's terrific.
Oh, that was terrific.
After you interviewed him, Rudolf, there was no question in your mind after listening to that the Holocaust existed.
Oh, God. Absolutely not. Oh, no, there's no question about it. That was a complete admission.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The only thing was, Hess told me that, well, I don't want to go into the whole detail, it's too long, but Hess told me that that they'd killed 2.5 million people. Not 3 billion people, 2.5 million were murdered and 500,000 died. And then when he wrote his autobiography, he said, no, that was wrong. That was too high. So, so it was 2 million. That's all.
They didn't execute him eventually?
No? Rudolf Hess, I sent him back to Poland. He was tried by the Polish Supreme Court of the equivalent, and he was convicted by that court and sentenced to die, and he was hanged on the grounds of Auschwitz. In fact, the gallows upon which he was hung were still there when I was last there. And I have a transcript of his testimony. I have a transcript of that trial, which I've never got translated. I'm working on it right now. And funny thing about it, the principal document in that transcript is the confession which he made to me at Nuremberg. They got that and put it in the record.
When you're spending 3 days interrogating somebody, and that's what he's telling you, how do you make sense of him as a human being? I mean, what was he like?
Rudolf Hess, I would say, would be like a clerk in a store, a very unimpressive individual, not stupid,
right,
by any means. But he hasn't any dramatic influence at
right.
all. Presence.
Right.
And very matter of fact. I didn't know at the time, but I subsequently found out that the confession that he gave me with respect to the number of people killed at Auschwitz was the same that he had given to the British when they captured him. So he apparently told the truth to the British, and then he told the truth to me too. He was very matter of fact, and he told the whole thing, and how he was appointed. He was at Sachsenhausen, and then he was given the task of setting up this concentration camp at what the Germans call Auschwitz, and this was a camp set up in anticipation of the war with Russia, mm-hmm. and was to be used primarily to take care of prisoners of war. Mm-hmm. But then in May of 1941, just before the attack, Himmler called Hirsch to Berlin, and Himmler said, Hirsch, we have a secondary war going along with this struggle, military struggle, and that's a war against the Jews. And he said, the decision has been reached that you shall convert this camp of Auschwitz into an extermination center. And he said, if we don't destroy the Jews during this war, the Jews are going to destroy Germany. So that's it. That's your war, that's your responsibility. And he says, Eichmann will bring the Jews and whatever other people that are on the list to Auschwitz, but you're to see that they're exterminated. So he said that was my duty, and I performed it.
Whitney, did you have any personal views on the death penalty going into all of this?
No, I didn't have any personal views on the death penalty. I do now, though.
You do?
I'm hesitant. I'll tell you a funny thing. I was at a conference in Nuremberg several years ago, and this was on Nuremberg trial, and I don't remember exactly what it was, but basically on the Nuremberg trial. And so we were talking, and something about the death penalty, and the people who were there of different countries in Europe said, "Well, we don't have the death penalty anymore." It struck me as rather surprising. I never thought that you could have a society and not have a death penalty for the most severe crime. They don't have the death penalty in Europe. So I've now come around to the view that maybe we should do away with the death penalty.
Even as you think back about a Rudolf Hirsch?
Well,
or a Kaltenbrunner, or
well,
these defendants. Yeah.
See, that's the problem.
That is the problem, isn't it? Right.
Yeah, that's the problem.
On the topic of punishment, let me ask you a little bit about the executions. October 16, 1946. You are the official representative of the American prosecution.
Right. I was Justice Jackson.
You were Jackson's personal representative. Yeah. Why wasn't he there? Was that simply a matter of the Supreme Court?
Why was he not there?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. No other chief prosecutor was there.
Okay.
No other prosecutor had a representative there. I was the only one.
Okay.
Yeah. I had no official connection at all. I was just there as an observer, and of course I wanted to observe for Justice Jackson and let him know what happened. That's all. No, I had no function at all. That was I was entirely. No other prosecutor had a representative. Oh well, that was the most dramatic thing that happened that night, as far as I was concerned. Along about 11 o'clock, as near as I can remember, the word came out that Goering had committed suicide before his execution, and you should have seen the newsmen run. To let everybody know that Goering had committed suicide. Goering left a couple of letters, those letters were turned over to the Allied Control Council, and I always wondered whether he admitted in those, or said in those letters, how he pulled this trick off. And I was never able to get the letters. But a fellow by the name of Ben Schweringen, years after the trial, really got interested in this matter. And he researched it up one side and down another. And he found out that there was each of these defendants had an American guard assigned to them who was more or less permanent. And Goering had a guard by the name of Tex Wheeler. Tex Wheeler was an American officer, I don't know, a lieutenant or something. And so Tex was the one that he'd contact if he needed something. And they became kind of a little bit friendly, so much so that Goering gave him his watch, which is a beautiful, expensive watch with initial Hermann Goering on it. And so Schweringen, he talked to me several times. Schweringen is convinced that what happened was that you couldn't hide the poison vial in the room, in the cell room. It's just impossible to hide it. They searched it so carefully. But the defendants had their personal belongings in a storage room, and they had the right to go there. Provided they were in the custody of an American officer, and maybe they want to get a book or something, I don't know. So Schweringen's view was, after his analysis, that probably Goering asked Tex Wheeler, they all knew that the execution was imminent, to take him to the storage room, and Tex may have turned the other way while Goering rummaged around there, and he found this vial, which he had hidden for this very occasion. And he got the vial, and that's the way he committed suicide that night. The reason I'm here is because of Justice Jackson.
Right.
And I want to indicate the tremendous contribution that Justice Jackson made at Nuremberg and to the world, and what an unbelievable person he was, and leader. That's what I'm here for.
Thank you. You were considered kind of his right-hand man or one of his right-hand men. I was wondering what we talked a little bit about, you know, the prisoners and so on. What did you do during the trial itself?
Well, I worked very hard during the trial itself in preparing the case against the Gestapo and the SD and Ernst Kaltenbrunner. And I did do some personal tasks for Justice Jackson. That's right. He assigned me some tasks. But I don't want anyone to think that I was a particularly important person at Nuremberg. I was just one of the staff. But I had a unique part of the lawsuit, which developed into something rather big, as it turned out. My job really was, as it developed, was the proof of the Holocaust, which is now very well accepted in the world. So that was important, and I had some. For example, when Justice Jackson cross-examined Hermann Göring, which was really a highlight of the trial, Justice Jackson asked me to assist in that cross-examination. Normally, when he was at the lawyer's podium, he would be assisted by his secretary, Elsie Douglas, or maybe his son, Bill Jackson. But for this particular task, I was very flattered that he wanted me to do that for him.
Do you agree with the critique of Jackson's performance that says he didn't do extremely well in that cross-examination?
I disagree with it just absolutely completely. Though I would say this, Justice Jackson outlined his cross-examination, planned his cross-examination of Göring by himself. I didn't have anything to do with that, the essential concept. And what he sought to do was to prove the conspiracy through Hermann Göring. And he did this by a series of questions relating to the seizure of power and the elimination of democracy or democratic government in Germany, establishing a dictatorship, planning for war and all this. And he did this and it went over very, very well. But the problem was that Göring went into speeches on his own, Justice Jackson would ask a question about what the Nazi leadership did, well then he'd retort, well that's just about what you do in the United States and all that kind of thing, and that this is possibly permissible comment, but it did upset Justice Jackson, and I can understand why. When we got into the specifics, and we had documents, and that was my job, really, to supply the documents, and we cross-examined, and Justice Jackson was able to cross-examine Göring on documents which he couldn't refute about the crimes against Jews, against what they did to American flyers and British flyers and he really issued the order for the final solution of the killing of the Jewish of the Jews of Germany, so in a letter to Heydrich, so he came off very, very badly, but what the public doesn't understand about that whole thing was this. The British were very concerned about having a trial in the first place. They, did not favor a trial. They favored proceeding by executive action. The reason is, they said, you will give these men a forum from which they can espouse their Nazi philosophy. It's better to get rid of them and not have that possibility. That was the British concern, and Jackson talked the British out of it. He said, we should have a trial, and run that risk if need be. Mm-hmm. So here the first defendant comes on the stand, the biggest, number two, Goering, and Goering is, and Jackson is cross-examining, and sure enough, the very thing happens that the British had warned about. Now, none of this has ever come out, as far as I know. This is the thing that worried Jackson, and worried me too, I thought, that this guy is going to get, you know, he's going to go so far, and he's going to accuse us of all kinds of crimes on our part and everything like that. And give them a chance to rebuild the spirit of Nazism in Germany, the very thing the British were concerned about. So that's why Justice Jackson had some difficulty with Goering, and but in the end he completely demolished Goering. Oh, there wasn't a thing left with Goering, and he lost his arrogance entirely by the. We gave him one document after another where he had obviously was involved in the worst aspects of the criminal enterprise. Mm-hmm. Well, Justice Jackson will always be a hero to me, right. Of course. I think that he is a truly brilliant, dedicated, honest leader of men. I think that Justice Jackson has to go down as possibly the finest legal writer of the last century. I mean, his composition is incredible. He talked about, did we help him in his speeches? He didn't need any help in his speeches. As far as phraseology is concerned, as far as, you know, he's just an absolute master. So, you know, he's really... And he made a tremendous contribution, I think, to our own civilization in assuming the responsibility of affording the Germans an opportunity to defend themselves after the end of the last war and proving their criminality. He was always extremely friendly to me. He was just attentive to any suggestion anybody made. And he asked me once in a while to write a memorandum on some matter of management of the staff, and I did that. And I wouldn't say that that we were close, because I was a little bitty boy and he was a great big leader, but naturally I had a great affection for him. Mm-hmm. But that was interesting when General Donovan came over. We had, I had collected quite a few documents while I was in OSS and turned them over, mm-hmm. saw that we got them down in Nuremberg. And then Bob Story, Colonel Story, came over, and he was Justice Jackson's first executive trial counsel. And he set up an office in Paris, and he got the documents from General Eisenhower, from the United States Army. He got a lot of documents. So altogether, we assembled a tremendous volume of incriminating documents, and the Germans wrote, put everything down in writing practically, so that we had just a very strong case on almost every issue. From a documentary standpoint. Well, General Donovan came over, and he felt that we should make a real strong, effective presentation from the outset by calling these witnesses to the stand and getting the accused to the stand as quickly as we could, and cross-examining them, and then using the documents in the course of the cross-examination like we do in an ordinary American trial. Bob Story felt that we had enough documentary case that would stand in history that we could just afford to proceed basically with a documentary case and supplement it with witnesses. And so that's why, then a controversy arose. How should we proceed? And Justice Jackson concluded that Bob's story was right and that we should go ahead with the documentary case. And this really left nothing for General Donovan to do. So General Donovan went home, and we went ahead with the documentary case. And we were each assigned. I had the task of assembling the documentary evidence, writing a brief against the Gestapo and the SD and against Ernst Kaltenbrunner. That was my job to do. And that was a basic, fundamental decision that Justice Jackson made there.
It did probably cost the trial some of the media and public excitement.
Exactly, of course.
At its
and
time.
Of course, and Justice Jackson knew that.
Right.
But he was, strong enough to realize that here we're not trying to do something for today, we're trying to do something for history, and we're trying to make a record here which will be unassailable, and he insisted that we go ahead with that.
Thought of whether Nuremberg would have been possible with Hitler in the dock?
Yes, I had. Oh, they never would have tried Hitler alone.
Okay.
But they would probably narrowed it down to 8 or 10 at the most. And
right.
And the first trial, I would have guessed, if you had Hitler at trial.
Right.
That's,
now,
I mean,
what about...
Because he's the Führer. He's
right.
The leader.
Right.
He's number one. All you have to do is to convict Hitler, and you've convicted everybody.
Right.
That would have been an exciting thing, all right. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I've imagined that a lot. What would Hitler have said in his defense? Well, I was close to Bill. We worked in an entirely different area. He was assisting his father. But occasionally I'd work with Bill on a speech that he was helping his father on. I did that. Yeah.
Okay. Elsie Douglas, what was she like?
Oh, well, Elsie Douglas is just an absolutely wonderful woman, and she ran the whole household while we were there. Bill and Justice Jackson and Elsie occupied the house right close to our house,
right,
and she not only had to do some entertaining in her house, but she did all of the secretarial work for Jackson. He couldn't possibly have gone along without her. He couldn't have, no way he could have made the...
Was there anybody else?
And she also assisted him even in his speeches, as I have said sometimes. I mean, with the notes and so forth.
Right.
I have to admit that I worked alone. Essentially,
mm-hmm.
I had my assignment, and I didn't have anybody else connected with me on that job. Now, of course, I was with the other guys. We'd meet at night and so forth. But as far as doing the work, I worked alone. But I shared the house with Bernie and Hartley. There were three or four of us in that same house. We were billeted together. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Sprecher had me. He reminds me that down at the Grand Hotel, new people would come in, we'd have a meeting and tell them all about how to run the trial, the trial was running and so forth. I don't remember much about it. So I was had contact with Sprecher. I, had contact with everybody, but mm-hmm. on a social basis. It was very good. The only two, I think, Speer got off a little bit light because Sauckel gets a death sentence and he's carrying out Speer's orders, but Sauckel's such a low type of individual compared to Speer, that's why the tribunal felt that way. Speer should have got a more severe sentence than he did. Whether it's death sentence or not, I don't know, but he should have got more.
I was shocked.
she's, I don't know. Jackson felt that that was the worst decision that they made on Schacht, to let Schacht off. But really, Schacht was out of it. By the time that the planning for aggression was beginning, Schacht was gone. Goering had kicked him out. So I think that Schacht should have been acquitted. Dönitz. Dönitz, as a Navy man, I thought Dönitz got, all of us in the Navy felt that Dönitz got too much. Dönitz should have been probably acquitted, even though he succeeded Hitler, because really we didn't have a case against him. We didn't have a case against Dönitz. It's just unfortunate for him that Himmler, Hitler named him to succeed him. And, you know, Dönitz got Admiral Halsey, his lawyer, Kranzbühler, got Halsey to sign an affidavit that we engage in unrestricted submarine warfare in the Pacific. Well, you know, conditions are not exactly the same. But in general, I thought the tribunal did an excellent job.
Do you think posterity will probably look with more, even more respect on the tribunal because, in fact, some people were acquitted? I mean, they found guilty.
Oh, I think so, and I think that the tribunal knew that too when they were arriving at their decision. Mm-hmm. I'll bet you, if everyone had been sufficient evidence to convict everyone, they'd have found some reason to acquit somebody to show that they. But I really do believe that the tribunal was very judicious. Now, of course, the Russians were not. They wanted to convict them all, you know. They were a little bit more realistic.
Around the indictment of Krupps and then attempting to indict the younger Krupps later.
Well, that was a terrible mistake. Mm-hmm. We really blew that one. Mm-hmm. They should have known that Krupps, he was so sick. He was in
95, wasn't
it? Yeah, he was in bed. He couldn't get out of bed even and so forth. And to indict him. And then Jackson, this is one thing that, well, let me say that it was probably not a good thing to indict the younger Krupp when we had to dismiss it, because it looks like, well, we can't get him, we can't get the father, so we get the son to represent industry. That has a bad and of course we never did come forward, we never did prove an economic case. Mm-hmm. They had a lot of guys working on the so-called economic case. Here I'm working all by myself. I got the Gestapo, the biggest thing in the trial. And here they got the economic case, and they got 40 guys working on the economic case. They can't come up with anything. Oh, God. I wouldn't want that. I wouldn't want to have been part of that team. I think the feeling was, though, at that time, that Hitler was supported and abetted by these big industrialists. And that it was, and we needed to have somebody, this was a representative group of defendants, and we really needed to have somebody to represent the industrial group. I mean, after all, let's face it, all these people were representative, so that I can understand the desire to get somebody. It's unfortunate that they picked the younger Krupp. We could have got somebody else. It would have been better. I was in charge of the legal advice branch for General Clay, and we had to review all legal matters going before the Allied Control Council as to their legal validity and so forth. And we also had representatives throughout Germany, throughout the American zone of Germany. A couple of funny things have happened. One time we had, before the Allied Control Council, a bill to permit the Salvation Army to reestablish its activities in Germany. So, of course, Salvation Army, everybody votes for that. Well, the Germans voted against it, and yet, no explanation.
The Russians.
The Russians.
Okay.
The Russians. And so, as we walked out, I noticed one of the Soviet assistants, whoever it was, got an encyclopedia in his arm. And so I asked him, well, does that encyclopedia have anything about the Salvation Army? He said, yeah. He said, that's right here. So it translated. This organization did contrary to proletariat objectives. That was the last sentence. And so that was the end of that. So, I think the Russians would fire off their guns all night long, keep us awake. See, we were in a little enclave.
Right.
It was.
So you were stationed in the Western Zone in Berlin.
Yeah, in the American sector of Berlin.
And how long were you in Berlin before you came home?
2 years. Came back from Berlin, where I was in charge of the legal advice branch for General Clay. Then I became a professor at SMU. And after that, I became the, I spent a year on the Hoover Commission in Washington, and another year as first executive director of the American Bar Association. Then I went to work for the Southwestern Bell Telephone Company, and I worked with the telephone company until I retired. Well, I had no idea that this trial would be as significant historically as it has proven to be, but of course it was a challenge. And being in Europe at the time, it's exciting to be with this trial. But of course, I had no idea that it would amount to have the impact that it has had on history that we find now. This was a lawsuit, and I had my portion of the case, and I had put it together and developed the evidence, and I was trying to win a lawsuit. That's the way I approached it. And I don't know whether others did or not, but we did conduct this case as a lawsuit. This was not an inquiry. We were trying to convict these fellows. I was trying my best to find the evidence to convict us. I think the most important thing was that the tribunal held that aggressive war is a crime in international law. That was the most important issue as far as Justice Jackson was concerned, mm-hmm. without any doubt. And of course, now we have the unfortunate situation where the United States took a position opposite to that in the negotiation for the Rome Statute to establish an international military tribunal. In other words, Bill Richardson stated at the outset that to define aggressive war is too difficult to do, and therefore aggressive war should not be included as a crime within the jurisdiction of the international military of the International Criminal Court. That is a grave setback, in my view, to the development of international law. Justice Jackson would not have proceeded with this trial unless the other powers went along with the concept that waging aggressive war was a major crime for which the German defendants and it follows any other defendants should be held accountable.
Sense of why that was, why the core of it for Jackson was aggressive war?
Yes, I know why it was, because Justice Jackson advised President Roosevelt on the giving of the destroyers to Great Britain, mm-hmm. that he could do so legally because Germany had committed an international crime, mm-hmm. in initiating this war. and that therefore it was proper for the United States to support a victim of that aggression. And Jackson pointed out that, of course, Germany never declared war against the United States. So in that technical sense, of course, we were not at war with them.
In 1940.
Yeah.
Yes.
So therefore, right, in 1940. So therefore, our reaction was, had to be based on the concept that to wage aggressive war is a crime, whether or not in contravention of a treaty, agreement, or assurance. Now, in the allocation of the responsibility for the presentation of the case, the United States took the fundamental position that waging aggressive war is a crime. Forget treaties. Forget that. That portion of the case, waging aggressive war in violation of a treaty or an agreement or an assurance, we left to Great Britain. That was the British part of the lawsuit.
Right.
One of the most dramatic days of my life. Well, the reason it had gone full circle is obvious, that we had tried the Germans for the type of crime, you see, that we are now dealing with for the International Criminal Court. This is a recognition by Germany today that what we did in Nuremberg was right, that the principles of law which we established in that proceeding were correct. And not only was the acceptance significant in itself, but the fact that the vote was 531-0, unanimous, that the Bundestag in Germany, 50 years after Nuremberg, now would embrace the Nuremberg concepts with unanimity. It's an almost incredible thing could happen. It was an extremely moving event for me. Contact, of course, with the German representatives at the Rome Conference, and I was with them there at when this proceeding took place in the Bundestag, and before the Bundestag, and. It was very exciting for me because Vollmer, who's the foreign minister, introduced me, you know. And so that was a tremendously dramatic day in my life, yeah.
Yeah, we've
hard enough for one sitting.
We're
yeah,
pretty hard
with it. Thank you.
Oh,